Good morning. My name's Stanley Kelly. We're down here today from Fellowship Baptist Church here in Goldsboro to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in the book of Galatians chapter 3, verse 21, is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For there had been a law given which could have given life. Verily, righteousness should have been by the law. But the scripture hath concluded all in the sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under our schoolmaster. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Paul says that the law, speaking of the Old Testament law, the commandments of God, was a schoolmaster or a teacher, an instructor, to bring us unto Christ. So we understand today that all of us today that claim to be saved, that claim to be Christians, one of the reasons why, the main reason, the main thrust as to why you and I are believers today stems from the law of God. Now the law, Paul says, being our schoolmaster, he's speaking of the Old Testament law, namely the Ten Commandments. Paul said it was those commandments that spoke to me and instructed me and gave me the information I needed that I might come to Christ. So the law is our teacher. In fact, it is one of the most valuable teachers that a person could ever have. So the question we'd like to answer today is, what is it that the law of God teaches us that brings us to Christ? Number one, the first thing that the law of God teaches us is about our sinfulness. The law of God teaches us that we are sinful. When we stop and we look at the law of God, under the whole umbrella of the Old Testament law, there are 613 precepts that we are to live our lives by. Those 613 precepts are summarized in a listing of 10 specific commandments that tells us what God expects out of us if we are to attain unto moral perfection. The Bible says in Matthew 5:48 that we are to be perfect as our Father which is in heaven is perfect. So the plumb line and the measuring stick as to what perfection is not civil America. It's not just what our parents taught us. It's not just what the public educational system has taught us. But the standard of perfection is the moral character of God. God requires of us that we should be just as perfect, just as holy, and just as righteous as He is. The Bible says that in God there is no sin, that He has never had a wrong thought. He has never committed a wrong action. He has never said a wrong word. And the Bible says that we are measured by that holy commandment, that by that kind of a standard inside our life. We are to be perfect. And whenever we look at the Ten Commandments, what we find out is that none of us measure up to the righteous standard of God. The Bible says in Exodus chapter number 20, the first commandment of the Ten Commandments is, thou shalt have no other gods before me. A lot of us in America think that we've never violated this command because we've never set up a totem pole inside our living room and bowed down and worship it, or because we don't have a big fat Buddha statue somewhere in the course of our living room that we bow down and we pray to on a regular basis. We think that we have never put any other god before our Creator. But we, out of all of the other nations in the world, are some of the worst when it comes to idolaters. Romans chapter number 1, Paul addressed the crowd of people that worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. The Bible tells us here that if we put anything before the God that gave us life, that we have become idolaters at heart. We have worshipped another god. To worship means to pledge your allegiance. It means to give your devotion. It means to give your life over to something. Here in America, we worship all kinds of idol gods.
We worship sporting events. We worship baseball. We worship basketball. We worship football. We worship recreation. We worship hunting. And we worship fishing. We worship relaxation. We worship sleep. We worship all of these things, don't we? We worship vacations. We'll give all of our money. We'll give all of our time and all of our energy, all of our devotion, all of these things, and all the while, we forget God, and we put God in the back burner, so to speak, inside our life. And we'll think things like this: I'll go to church if it fits into my schedule. I'll read my Bible if I feel like it. I'll love God when it's convenient for me to love God. Did you know the majority of people find it convenient to worship God and to love God when they desperately need Him? When they find themselves in a pitiful situation of life, then that is when they seek to go after God and want to follow after God. But if we do not always seek God with all of our heart in every second of every day, we are guilty of violating the first of the Ten Commandments. The third of those commandments, the Bible says that we are not to take the name of the Lord our God in vain. Now, a lot of folks believe that to take God's name in vain means that you use the name of God to place a four-letter curse word to express disgust. And that is one way that a person can violate the third commandment. We are not to use the name of God. We are not to stub our toe or to have something bad happen to us and to flippantly call out the name of God to express disgust. That is in violation of the third commandment. But it goes much deeper than that. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 14, the Bible says, "If my people," God says, "if my people, which are called by my name," that is a line of identification. When you are called by someone's name, it means that you belong to that person. My last name is Kelly, denoting that I belong to the Kelly family. My mother and my father's last name is Kelly. It is that I belong. There's a processor or a right of identification. I belong to them. So when we refer to ourselves as Christians, we bear the name of Christ. We are identifying ourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, saying that we belong to Him. And the Bible says that we are not to take that name to ourselves in vain. We are not to call ourselves Christians. We are not to call ourselves believers and not live like we are believers. That is to violate the third commandment. How many folks across Goldsboro and across Wayne County would say that I love God, would say that God is amazing inside my life? But how many of us sought the Lord this morning in prayer? How many of us care to open up a Bible and to read from its pages and to give our allegiance to Him? How many of us pray this morning and ask God to direct our paths, to guide our steps, and to help us to live in a way that we shall live our lives and conduct our actions during the course of one day? The Bible says that we are to honor our mothers and fathers, that our days may be long upon the land in which the Lord thy God gives us to live. We are to honor our parents. And by the way, the Bible never tells us that there's a quitting point for any of these commandments. A lot of us think that we're supposed to honor our parents when we're 7 or 8 years old. But we're supposed to honor our mothers and fathers through the longevity of our lives. That means that if our parents never told us when we were up underneath their authority inside our homes, when our parents told us to do something, if we rebelled against that, if we didn't like to do what they told us to do, the Bible says that we are guilty of violating the fifth of the Ten Commandments. You see, the law is our schoolmaster. It exposes our sinfulness. What the law shows us is that we are not as good as all the other people think we are. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs that most people are everyone his own goodness. We love to pretend that we're better off than we really are. We want everybody to think that we're holier than God and that we're righteous. Even a lot of church-going people like to hold on to that.